Okay, welcome to part two of World War II in American World War II. We are going to pick up with the war. And of course, as we know, in AP US history, military history is off the table. However, as fans of World War II, we will address some of the battles and some of the campaigns. And ultimately, like any other war in a push, we need to understand turning points. And so we will address the battles that served as significant turning points during the conflict. So we left off with, in video one, the bombing of Pearl Harbor. And with the bombing of Pearl Harbor, the United States is going to be drawn into not only a war in the Pacific, but also a war in Europe. If you recall, Adolf Hitler, 3 days after Pearl Harbor, is going to declare war on the United States. There were, during the war, a number of wartime conferences, and ultimately you're going to need to be familiar with these wartime conferences, as they are very important moments, diplomatic moments. So we have what's called the big three leaders of the Allies, FDR representing the United States, Winston Churchill representing the great United Kingdom, Joseph Stalin representing the Soviet Union. Now, the very first meeting to discuss wartime strategy is the Casablanca Conference. It's the only conference that Stalin is not present. Okay, so the only two meeting are FDR and Churchill. At the time, Stalin is essentially fighting the Nazis by himself. He's experiencing kind of the brunt of the Nazi war machine. So he's got his hands full. So, but with the Casablanca Conference, this meeting between FDR and Churchill in Morocco, two very important agreements are made. Number one, both men agreed to accept nothing less than an unconditional surrender from Hitler. So unlike World War I, this war will end with the absolute total defeat of Germany. Germany is not going to be allowed to surrender on their terms. And number two, the agreement is made to defeat Germany first, then focus on Japan. Now, of course, Stalin was furious at what was decided at the conference because the unconditional surrender demand really strengthened the German will to fight. And as I mentioned before, Germany and the Soviets are locked in a grudge match on the Eastern Front, well within Russia. And of course, at the time, the Soviets, you know, they were experiencing massive casualties, and the unconditional surrender demand made the Germans fight a little bit harder, and so Stalin is furious. So here you got a map of essentially what the war looks like on the map. The United States will enter the European theater. Not necessarily through Europe, but rather right here through Africa, okay, through Morocco. And so this is called Operation Torch. Operation Torch, because if you look at the continent of Africa on a map, it looks like a torch. And so essentially the goal was to drive the Germans out of Northern Africa, which they're going to be able to do in very short order. The army, the American army, was led by General George S. Patton, and the British army, led by Bernard Montgomery. They're going to drive the Germans to Tunisia, where they will flee into Italy. And that's essentially the, you know, 1942-1943 in the war. After the Germans are expelled from Africa, General Patton is going to invade Sicily, liberate Sicily, and then, as you see here, we'll enter the war in continental Europe through Italy. Okay. And so I'm going to tell you that some of the hardest fighting in the entire war was through Italy. German units in Italy, German units defending the southern approaches into Germany. Some of the hardest fighting of the war was there in Italy, and a great deal of suffering occurs in the conflict in Italy. Interesting point to make is that by 1943, when the Americans and the British arrive in Italy, the people of Rome essentially lynched Mussolini and his mistress, brought him out to the street, beat him to death, tied them both up by their feet at a lamppost, and they took a bat to him. They basically brutally killed. They kill Mussolini. They overthrow Mussolini. Mussolini is going to be toppled. And so I think it's interesting to note that during World War II, Italy is going to switch sides during the war. Okay, Italy is going to be the first of the Axis powers to fall. Okay, so ultimately, we've got by 1943, we've got action in Italy, and over here on the Eastern Front, is you've got the Soviets are in a bit of a grudge match with the German army. Suffering millions and millions of casualties on that Eastern Front. Let's continue here. So we talked about Operation Torch. That's this effort to liberate Africa. The Battle of Stalingrad, if we go back, Stalingrad is kind of off the map here. In fact, let me move here. So Stalingrad, obviously, is the city. It's an industrial center in the Soviet Union. It was a city that really both Hitler and Stalin were very stubborn in terms of wanting to possess and control. Stalin is going to pour millions and millions of troops into holding the city. In fact, the Germans are going to occupy and control about 90% of the city. But Stalin, he decided to make a stand in Stalingrad and poured massive numbers of troops into the effort to recapture Stalingrad. Now, Hitler was encouraged by his advisors to withdraw from Stalingrad, but instead held the line, and ultimately suffered enormous casualties. And in fact, the lion's share of Hitler's army in Stalingrad will eventually be captured by the Soviet Red Army. This is actually, if we go back and look, the Battle of Stalingrad, if you're going to look at just the totality of the war, it is probably the most important turning point in World War II in Europe because of the staggering losses that Hitler sustained during this campaign. And, you know, it's like you go back to Napoleon. You know, Napoleon made a mistake by invading Russia in his effort of world conquest. And I'd say that Adolf Hitler also paid a huge price by waging war against the Soviets, something really that he didn't have to do, but stubbornly did so. So after Stalingrad, you've got the Red Army you're going to see a very sustained push westward towards Berlin. All right. So we're going to have this big race to Berlin. In 1943, we also had what was called the Tehran Conference. In Tehran, the Big Three agreed that the United States and the Allies, the British, would enter Western Europe through Normandy. They would open up a second front, Okay, and this was the cause of a great deal of consternation between Stalin and the other allies, is, you know, the tardiness in opening up a second front in Europe. You know, by opening up a second front in Europe, it forces Hitler to essentially divide his forces between an Eastern and a Western front. And that would take a lot of pressure off of the fighting in the Eastern front. So in Stalin, we're going to learn, really feels like the Allies did this on purpose, that they delayed in opening a second front in Europe in order to really have a tremendous amount of losses inflicted on really both armies. So you got the big turning point in the East, on the Eastern Front, it's the Battle of Stalingrad. On the West, of course, is going to be Operation Overlord, or what we know today as D-Day. And then, of course, we go to D-Day. Obviously, the planner of the D-Day invasion was Dwight David Eisenhower. Eisenhower is the supreme commander of all Allied forces during World War II. As you can see, we held significant bases in England. England is pretty much a staging ground for what's going to happen in northern France. Now, the Germans were convinced that we were going to land here at Calais. See Calais right here. It's right across the English Channel from Dover. See Dover. So this was a big. This is what Hitler was convinced, that we were going to land here. And so essentially what the Germans, you know, anticipating an invasion, they are going to spread their forces all along the northern coast here, okay? But they had much of it concentrated here, as you can see, these divisions of support right here at Calais. But nonetheless, Dwight Eisenhower in Operation Overlord is going to set up a landing zone. There's five beachheads that were divided, in which the Allies would enter Western Europe from. Utah Beach, Omaha Beach, Gold, Juno, and Sword. All right, so Canadian, British, American, and French forces are going to enter Europe right here in Normandy, okay, the Normandy invasion. 2 weeks before the landing, U.S. battleships are going to sail up and down the coast of France, pounding these German guns, artillery, trying to soften up the landing zones. You can see the bombings that nightly American, British bombers are going to fly behind enemy lines and bomb railroads, bomb German assets. I mean, we're talking weeks before. So this is a very intense, very complicated, it had many different parts to the plan, to D-Day. And ultimately, they were supposed to land on June 5th, 1944, but because of bad weather, they had to delay it a day. And so on June 6th, 1944, that's when we have the landing on the beaches in part of the D-Day operation. The night of the landing, the hours before the landing, American paratroopers were dropped behind enemy lines. So as our boys were coming ashore, the Germans were having to worry about their rear as well as the men coming ashore. Now there was one place, one of the beachheads, the paratroopers missed their drop zones, and that was Omaha. And Omaha Beach, therefore, the Germans had no pressure from the rear, and so Omaha was a bloodbath. It was very, very high casualties. So Eisenhower, hours before the landing, hours before the operation, he sends a letter to his troops. I attached a copy of that letter. All right, so we'll find it here. Soldiers, sailors, and airmen of the Allied Expeditionary Force, you are about to embark on the great crusade toward which we have striven these many months. The eyes of the world are upon you. The hope and prayers of liberty-loving people everywhere march with you. In company with our brave allies and brothers of arms on other fronts, you will bring about the destruction of the German war machine, the elimination of Nazi tyranny over the oppressed peoples of Europe, and security for ourselves in a free world. Your task will not be an easy one. Your enemy is well-trained, well-equipped, and battle-hardened. He will fight savagely. But this is the year 1944. Much has happened since the Nazi triumphs of 1940-41. The United Nations have inflicted upon the Germans great defeats in open battle, man-to-man. Our air offensive has seriously reduced their strength in the air and their capacity to wage war on the ground. Our home fronts have given us an overwhelming superiority in weapons and munitions of war and place at our disposal great reserves of trained fighting men. The tide has turned. The free men of the world are marching together to victory. I have full confidence in your courage, devotion to duty, and skill in battle. We will accept nothing less than full victory. Good luck. And let us beseech the blessing of Almighty God upon this great and noble undertaking. Dwight David Eisenhower. Handwritten, unissued message says, our landings in Cherbourg, Havre area have failed to gain a satisfactory foothold. I've withdrawn the troops. My decision to attack at this time and place was based upon the best possible information. The troops, the air, and the Navy all did all that bravery and devotion to duty could do. If any blame or fault attaches to the attempt, it is mine alone. So this is, again, a guy willing to take the blame for the failure, you know, which is it's an amazing thing to do, to see in a leader. And so D-Day, you know, there's one historian that referred to D-Day as the day that democracy was saved. You know, democracy's greatest day, you know, and that's essentially what happened. I want to play this. This one here will bring you to tears, and it's pretty long. But I'm going to play this one.
Today marks 74 years since the D-Day invasion. It also marks an opportunity for us to visit with an old friend who landed on Omaha Beach at 6:30 in the morning this day in 1944.
I wish I could keep going back every year because I love that hallowed ground. I want to get down there and I want to talk to these guys.
Sergeant Major Robert Bladnick of Rowlett, part of the Big Red One, finally able to go back to Omaha Beach, but it was 2013. We were there with him, and what happened on that visit is as emotional and as powerful today as it was then. He hasn't touched this sand in 69 years.
I have just the most I walked in years now. And I keep on going. I just can't stop. I've got to get there and see where that draw is moving up.
And at the age of 93, after walking over a quarter mile in the sand, Robert Blatnick's arrival on this stretch of Omaha Beach is a moment that brings him to his knees.
Oh, dear Father in heaven, thank you for saving me. And oh, I thank you, men, that gave up their life for us. Oh, thank you, dear Lord, for what you've done for us. I give you thanks, dear Lord, and may all these souls rest in peace. I know you're taking good care of them.
He came to see again the exact spot where he landed June 6, 1944, and then watched over half his men die.
When we landed, we had 901 men. We finally got a count. The next day, I think we had 387. So that was terrible.
Sergeant Major Robert Bladnick was and forever will be a part of the Army's 1st Division, the Big Red One. He's back on Omaha in the same sector he came ashore. It's called Fox Red One. His recollection of the hell he survived on this beach is very clear.
And it was that sound over and over.
Over and over, just constant.
He remembers crawling through this sand, but never stopping.
Well, that's how the guy said, let's dig in, sir. I said, like hell, we got to get up off there. This, you dig your grave here. We got to get up to find the enemy. That's the only way we'll survive.
The sergeant major had a good teacher. He served in two invasion campaigns prior to D-Day with a decorated soldier who chose him as his right-hand man. That was Teddy Roosevelt Jr., whose gravesite is nearby at the American Cemetery in Colville-sur-Mer.
It's a miracle that I was able to come back here. I would never thought I'd never even dreamt that I'd be able to come back here.
This is Omaha Beach at low tide, and this is relatively the same conditions that they had back in 1944. And for Robert Blatnick, he had to make that run from out there all the way up to here. His first point of cover would have been the cliff line right here along the beach. And here we are 69 years later, and he has no idea why he survived and others didn't.
Taking your men for sacrifice you left for me, and I give you thanks for that. And I wish that I had taken my life instead of yours, that you could have survived instead of me.
Blatnick's return to D-Day included many heartfelt moments, from the thanks of local school children who knew well the story of his men and the fight for liberation, to the quiet salutes to those who didn't return. It's allowed him to say goodbye to friends. It's allowed him to make peace where war once ruled. Was it worth it?
I think it was worth it because now we got peace and we got democracy restored. I think that was worth it.
So again, an encore performance of a piece.
Okay. Shortly after D-Day, let me go back here. So within 2 weeks of D-Day, we were able to land, the Allies were able to land thousands of troop transports, tanks, and other mechanized machinery through that beachhead. That's why that beachhead was so important, is that we needed a place where our troops and our equipment could come ashore. And so within 2 weeks of D-Day, the Allied forces were in Paris. Paris is going to be liberated. And so what you have is, after D-Day, if we go back, the Americans and the Brits and the Canadians will be pushing the Germans back to Berlin from the east. The Soviets would be driving the Germans back to Berlin to the west. And so really what the rest of the war from 1944 to 45 was this push, this race to get to Berlin. Now, as the Americans crossed over into Germany, German resistance stiffened. This is called the Battle of the Bulge, where you really started to see the German lines solidify. All right, this is like was what the Battle of the Bulge is what we call. Here it is, number four. This is like the last great German counterattack, in which the Germans pretty much, this is their last ditch effort to try to turn the war in their favor. And it was extremely bloody for the Americans. The United States lost 19,000 troops in the Battle of the Bulge. So it was a tremendous sacrifice, But one of the things that's true is as Allied armies were driving towards Berlin, it became very apparent that the rumors of the concentration camps were not rumors, that we began to learn of the horrible reality of the existence of these German death camps. I attached a U.S. government communication to FDR of news of the camps. So that's something you could read at home. I'm not going to do it right here. But FDR, eventually will die April 12th, 1945, weeks before VE Day. VE Day is May 7th, 1945, and that is the day that Germany surrendered. The Red Army beat the United States to Berlin, and of course, by then, Hitler, as well as many top Nazi leaders, had committed suicide, and the Germans were beaten. And so I included a clip from Band of Brothers, a great documentary about Easy Company and its and Easy Company's trials during the war. They uncovered one of the death camps in Western Germany. And so I will play this.
Stand back. Give us some room here. Stand back. Back. Back.
Care. Give them water and any spare rations you might have. Grab me some blankets, quick.
Oh my God. Dick?
You said the guards left this morning, sir. Langsam, bitte, langsam.
Zuvor verbrannten sie noch einige der Baracken.
They burned some of the hot storage.
Mit den Gefangenen immer noch drinnen. Leben, sir.
Were the prisoners still in them, sir? Alive.
Jesus Christ. Aber einige von den Gefangenen haben sie versucht, daran zu
schauen. Some of the prisoners to try to stop.
Sie wurden getötet.
Some of them were killed.
Getötet. Die Wachen hatten nicht genug.
They didn't have enough ammo for all the prisoners, so.
Töteten so viele sie konnten.
Killed as many as they could.
Und dann verließen sie einfach das Lager.
So they left the camp.
Schlossen das Tor hinter sie und gingen Richtung Süden.
And headed south.
Someone in town must have told them they were coming.
Yeah, I think so.
Will you ask him what kind of camp this is? Why are they here?
Was ist das hier?
passieren. Das ist ein Arbeitslager für Unerwünschte, wirklich.
He says it's a war camp for Unerwünschte. I'm not sure what the word means, sir. Unwanted? Disliked, maybe?
Criminals?
I don't think criminals, sir. Verbrechen?
No. Ärzte, Musiker, Beamte, Bauern,
Musician,
Schreiber, Schneider,
Tailors, clerks, farmers, and electricians, and other people.
Juden.
Jews.
Polen. Zigeuner.
Polnische Jews.
Aber ich glaube, das stimmt. Und das Frauenlager ist bei der nächsten Bahnstation.
Wie bitte? Was sagen Sie?
Das ist das Frauenlager bei der nächsten Bahnstation.
Geil.
Wie Gott.
Oh. Women's Camp is at the next railroad station.
Geil.
So, yeah, it's hard to watch. Well, the last meeting of the big three, this is, of course, is as the war is coming to an end. The end of the war is pretty close in sight. This is the very important conference. You need to know it. It's the Yalta Conference. It was, like I said, the last meeting of the big three, FDR, Winston Churchill, Joseph Stalin in February of 1945. Of course, FDR will be dead in 2 months. All right. Remember, he dies on April 12th of 1945. But there's some very important agreements here that are made regarding the post-war. One, Stalin agrees to enter the war against Japan as soon as Germany is defeated. They issue what's called the Declaration of Liberated Europe, in which all three leaders agreed that once the war was over, free elections would be held in at war's end, especially in Eastern Europe. Number three, they called for the adoption of a world organization to meet in the United States beginning April 25th, 1945, which we know today as the United Nations. Remember, as the United Nations was born in principle in the Atlantic Charter in 1941. Germany would also be divided into occupation zones, that when the war was over, the Allies would basically divide Germany into occupation zones, and they would rebuild Germany and then ultimately reunify it. Now, other than number three, Joseph Stalin is going to renege on the other promises that were made, number one, number two, and number four, and that helped to lay the foundation of the Cold War, the rivalry between the United States and the Soviet Union after World War II. Okay, here's your occupation zones. So obviously, when the war is over, the gray is represented by the Russians. The United States is here in Bavaria. It's in green. Okay, the French in orange. And then, of course, you have the British in the yellow zone here. Okay, so, and ultimately at war's end, you notice that certain areas will be jointly occupied by the Allied powers, especially Berlin. Berlin will be divided amongst the three powers, as well as Vienna and Hamburg, okay? So, now the war in the Pacific, a general strategy in the war in the Pacific was island hopping. Basically, the United States was going to liberate the islands of the Pacific from the Japanese army, basically island by island, okay? Now, one of the first major failures of the war is going to be the invasion of the Philippines. The Japanese are going to invade the Philippines and defeat the Americans holding the Philippines. Now, as as the Japanese take the Philippines, American General Douglas MacArthur is going to retreat from the Philippines. And as he does so, he announces to the people over the radio that he would quote, "I shall return." Okay, something he will do in 1944-45. He will return to liberate the Philippines. Now, the American troops, there were a number of American troops that were captured as POWs by the Japanese. And the survivors were forced to engage in what was called the Bataan Death March, which was an 85-mile forced march of US GIs. And when they reached the end of their destiny, by the way, if they fell out during that march due to exhaustion or dehydration, the Japanese just simply killed them on that forced march. And the ones that made it to the end were tortured and then burned alive. So that's a total of 10,000 men who were brutally killed by the Japanese in the Bataan Death March. And in all fairness, 9,000 of those 10,000 men were Filipino and 1,000 were Americans who were brutalized. Another very important event after Pearl Harbor is the Doolittle Raid. And it was a raid that was extremely dangerous. And it was the first symbolic bombing of Tokyo. It was very important to FDR after Pearl Harbor that we hit Japan immediately. The problem is we didn't have any air bases that were close enough to launch a bombing raid. And so they, part of Doolittle's raid, James Doolittle was the Air Force commander who basically worked out a scheme by which these bombers would take off, as you can see in this picture here, off of aircraft carriers. And of course, in order for these bombers to take off, they had to strip the planes of all, they had to make them as light as possible because there's just simply isn't enough runway for these big planes to take off. And this is something the Japanese didn't think we'd be able to do. But nonetheless, the Americans were able to hit at the heart of Tokyo in what was called Doolittle's Raid. Okay. Then we have the Battle of Coral Sea. Battle of Coral Sea essentially halted Japanese aggression. You can see in this map, it halted Japanese aggression from threatening Australia and New Zealand. Now, tactically, it was a huge victory for Japan, but strategically, it was a huge victory for the Allies. It was, unfortunately, the Lexington, as you can see here in the photograph, the aircraft carrier, the Lexington, is going to be sunk. And so, hold on, the Yorktown is going to be sunk. And so we lost a carrier, but nonetheless, the South Pacific, Japanese aggression of the South Pacific was halted. Okay. Okay, so next we have Guadalcanal. Guadalcanal is another major moment in the war in the Pacific. It was a campaign fought in the Solomon Islands. Solomon Islands, of course, are an American possession. It was fought from August 1942 to February 43. It was the first major offensive and decisive victory for the Allies in the Pacific theater. It enabled the United States to take possession of a Japanese air base. And really, it demonstrated the resolve of the U.S. Marines against a very a vicious and gritty enemy. I included a video from a series called The Pacific, which really showed you the nature of the fighting in these islands. It was a very, very brutal, brutal setting to have these battles. Then we have the Battle of Midway. Of course, Midway is they just released a movie recently called Midway. Highly recommend you watch it. But really, the balance of power in the Pacific was all about aircraft carriers. and the Japanese tried to entice our aircraft carriers into the open waters of the Pacific in order to destroy them. The Japanese did have a numerical advantage in the number of aircraft carriers, and the United States dealt a severe blow to the Japanese at Midway by destroying four Japanese carriers to the American one. We lost one carrier to their four, and this is considered, the Battle of Midway is considered to be the turning point of the war in the Pacific. This is because the loss of those carriers severely crippled the Japanese war effort for the remainder of the war. By the way, the admiral in charge of the Pacific War, the naval war, is Chester Nimitz. Nimitz, of course, is the favorite son of Fredericksburg, Texas. If you go to Fredericksburg today, they have a World War II museum. It's a museum of the Pacific War. And, of course, that is his hometown. They have his home, his boyhood home, restored. But one of the great heroes of the Pacific War is Admiral Nimitz. And as I mentioned, Douglas MacArthur, by war's end, did exactly as he said he would. He would return, retake the Philippines. I want to move real quick. I'll come back. This is the way the war looked. So basically, you can see island hopping is we're going to go island to island, and we're going to remove the Japanese off these islands. And some of the bloodiest fighting in the entire war, here's the Solomon Islands down here. This is where Guadalcanal is. Okay. This is what island hopping is. But ultimately, just imagine going island to island, these island chains, and removing these Japanese off the islands. Like I said, very, very hard, very brutal fighting. And eventually, the Philippines will be taken in early 1944. You got the Battle of Leyte Gulf here. Battle of Leyte Gulf was known for its kamikaze. The kamikaze pilots, the Japanese suicide pilots, 80 American ships are going to be sunk simply by kamikazes. Very brutal, brutal way of fighting here. But ultimately, by this time, the Japanese really don't have a whole lot left. Again, this is in late 1944. The war then progressed as you follow the arrows. And these are two that I definitely want you to know. One is Iwo Jima, and the other battle is Okinawa. Okay, Iwo Jima and Okinawa. Iwo Jima was an island, volcanic island, that the United States wanted to build an air base. Big thing is, in order to defeat Japan, we knew that at some point we were going to have to invade Japan. That we were going to have to put boots in the ground in Japan. There were 20,700 Japanese troops defending the island of Iwo Jima. 6,000 U.S. Marines died taking it. And pay attention when I tell you this. This is pretty crazy. Of the 20,700 Japanese troops defending Iwo Jima, there were only 200 survivors because they fought to the death. In the Japanese shogun spirit, they believed it was dishonorable to be captured. They thought it was dishonorable to be a POW, that they thought it was honorable to die in battle. And that's a pretty tough enemy to fight when you're fighting someone who wants to die. That's tough. I mean, that's hard. So Iwo Jima, I'd say some of the hardest fighting in the entire war at Iwo Jima. It is a proud moment for the U.S. Marine Corps. The U.S. Marine Corps Memorial in Washington, D.C. is the a statue of the flag raising on the volcanic island, the highest point, Mount Suribachi, I think the name of it is. There's the name of the mountain there. The raising of the flag at Iwo Jima is considered to be a, iconic moment in the history of the Marine Corps. After taking Iwo Jima, they next took Okinawa, which is spent. This is Japanese soil here. It's actually part of Japan, Okinawa. And Okinawa is a little bit more severe. They wanted Okinawa for the same reason. They wanted United States wanted an air base where we could launch bombing raids into Japan. And Okinawa, there were, let me see, 110,000 Japanese. 110,000 Japanese died trying to hold on to the island. 7,600 Marines were killed taking the island. And kind of a crazy moment in this war, or in this particular battle at Okinawa, is that civilians on Okinawa went to the north. It's either the north or the south rim of the island. Went to the shore, and they threw themselves off of cliffs. That we had like mass suicide. They did not, you know. So when the Americans came ashore and they took the island, the civilians committed mass suicide. I mean, so this is pretty crazy stuff, man. Pretty crazy stuff. But it just shows you the extent to which the Japanese were willing to fight to the death in that spirit. So that being said, let's look at what we have next. And like I said, this is the Iwo Jima flag raising moment. I put a video of it on your website here on the PowerPoint. So, you know, feel free to look at it. And here's a clip from a movie made. It's called The Sands of the Letters from Iwo Jima, a movie that was made by Clint Eastwood. Okay. But it just shows you the brutality of the fighting. It goes to show what you learn is that for the Japanese that surrendered at Iwo Jima, it was largely because of dehydration. You know, if you go back and you look at these islands in the Pacific, one thing that these islands lacked was water, fresh water. And so dehydration was probably one of the greatest enemies to either soldier on either side. It's just a very, very tough place to fight, you know? So, ultimately, okay, so I have some outside readings here, some diaries, James Fahey. Look at that one real quick. Pacific War Diary. No. The Death of Cats, a good one. We Need to Exterminate Them, which is the dehumanizing of the enemy. That's very important to read. And the Japanese propaganda, the Tokyo Rose. Those are all really, really cool. We're not going to do it now, but you have access to this definitely at home. Okay, so let's continue. So what ends the war in the Pacific is technology. You know, ultimately this becomes a war of technology. I think what the war did reveal is Japanese are going to be very hard to defeat, you know. 1939, the letter from Albert Einstein to FDR, I attached the letter, but essentially FDR is going to be warned by Einstein that that Germany was in the process of building an atomic bomb. And so this led to the creation of the Manhattan Project, which is the code name given to the government program to build the atomic bomb in Los Alamos, New Mexico. The location of a very, very secret lab. The project manager of the Manhattan Project was J. Robert Oppenheimer. And by 1945, July 1945, they produced three bombs at Los Alamos. One was detonated here at Trinity, which is out in the middle of nowhere. It's out in the middle of the desert in New Mexico. And then two other bombs, one codenamed Little Man, the other one codenamed Fat Boy. And after the death of FDR, our new president, Vice President Truman, had a pretty big decision to make about what, you know, how are we going to end this war against the Japanese? So Part of the decision was made at Potsdam. All right, this is another wartime conference. This time, you're looking at Harry Truman, Stalin, and the new British prime minister. Winston Churchill is no longer prime minister, and his name is Clement Attlee. Okay, so the significance of the Potsdam conference, Stalin begins to renege on promises that he made at Yalta. You know, no free elections in Eastern Europe and no help with Japan. And so Truman became very angry. And it was here at Potsdam that Truman ordered the dropping of the atomic bombs on Hiroshima and then 3 days later on Nagasaki. And many historians argue that one of the reasons Truman ordered the dropping of the bomb was to intimidate the Soviet Union, to send a message to the communist world that the United States was the dominant power on the planet. So they did collectively issue a warning to Japan to surrender or to face complete and utter destruction. And the fact is, the emperor refused to step down. And the Japanese government, interestingly enough, was willing to surrender as long as they were able to keep their government. And so that was absolutely not part of the plan. We demanded an unconditional surrender from Japan. So what ended the war, August 6, 1945, obviously the atomic bombs are going to be used. I think it's important to note, and this is there's a lot of documents on the website regarding this, but Truman, his military advisors told him that in order to invade Japan, in order to win the war by invading Japan, to expect 1 million casualties. 1 million U.S. casualties, 500,000 British casualties. So he had a decision. He's like, do we invade and lose 1 million Americans, or do we use these two bombs? And so he used the bombs. Again, it's a moral decision. This is a very moral issue. No matter how you feel about whether it was right or wrong to drop the bombs, I think, you know, I like to say that both sides are right. But on August 6, 1945, the first one was dropped on Hiroshima. 80,000 died immediately. 100,000 were injured. Many later died to radiation sickness and cancer. The bomb was dropped by the plane. You see the plane and the men who flew the big bomber. It's called the Enola Gay. And by the way, prior to dropping the bombs, the Americans dropped leaflets, sent out a number of warnings to evacuate. And, you know, so there were steps that were taken, but to no avail. On August 8th, the Soviets decide to enter the war against Japan and they invade Manchuria. And now the Japanese are like really, really worried here that the Soviets are in the war. And the next day, the second bomb was dropped on Nagasaki, 60,000 killed instantly. And still, Japan refused to surrender unless the emperor was allowed to stay on the throne. But ultimately, the surrender did come. And I attached some videos here about the bombs. You can watch them at your leisure. But eventually, it was the emperor that went to the government and said, we must surrender. And so Emperor Hirohito surrendered to Douglas MacArthur on board the USS Missouri. And that ended the war in Japan. And that's called VJ Day, Victory Over Japan Day. That's August 14th, 1945. And here you have the iconic photo of the sailor kissing the nurse. I have actually an autographed picture of this where I've got the sailor actually autographed photo. Come in my room sometime, I'll show it to you. But this is an iconic image, obviously, and you can see people out in the streets of Times Square celebrating the end of the war in the Pacific. So, I mean, what lingers behind is this moral dilemma. Was dropping the atomic bomb the right decision? You know, I would like for us to do this assignment. I'm going to give you a lot of time to work on it. It's due April 3rd. write a position paper, 2 to 3 pages, double-spaced, either opposing or supporting Truman's use of the bomb, and you must cite at least 3 sources. So you'll find a lot of sources on my website, and of course you may have to Google, but I want you to take a position and do a 2 to 3 page, double-spaced position paper on the atomic bomb. Now, what World War II revealed about warfare was just the absolute destruction that the airplane, you know, the airplane was really, it's going to change war forever. And let's take, for example, what happened in Germany at Dresden. Okay, so Dresden is a German city. It's located roughly in the central part of the country. Due to Allied bombing raids of Germany throughout 1944-45, Dresden became a place where refugees went to. You know, it was a place where people would go to escape. I will tell you also, the Germans, Dresden was a place that the Germans kept a lot of American POWs, okay, where they kept American POWs. Sorry. So February 13th, 15th, 1945. Hold on a second. I'm going to hold for a second. Allied bombers are going to drop 2,700 tons of bombs and incendiary bombs on Dresden. This is considered to be one of the most controversial decisions of the war by the Allies. Okay, it was ordered 1 month after the Battle of the Bulge and 3 weeks after Auschwitz, one of the worst concentration camps, was discovered by Allied forces. The bombing sought to create a refugee problem and a transportation crisis for the Germans, and instead, it killed an estimated 150 to 200,000 people. The Allies sought through this bombing to terrorize the German population throughout the country in order to bring a surrender. One significant shift in warfare, as I mentioned before, was the new capability to use air power to kill thousands of people on the ground, as well as the ability to deliver weapons of mass destruction in order to destroy population centers. And this is what you see here in Dresden. Kurt Vonnegut, American writer, was a US POW held at Dresden at the time and became the subject of an iconic work of literature called Slaughterhouse-5. And so Slaughterhouse-5, I can tell you, in one of my grad school classes this past summer, in my World War II lit class, I read Slaughterhouse-5, and it's highly, highly, highly recommended. It's an awesome, awesome story. Another important anti-war World War II novel related to the use of airplanes and just the nature of war itself, Joseph Heller's Catch-22, another amazing read for those that are interested. But one hard, hard reality that emerged from the end of the war was the Holocaust. The fact that the Holocaust was very apparent, that what Jewish leaders in the United States had warned FDR about had actually solidified. It was actually true. It says here, as Allied forces began to push closer and closer to Berlin, it became apparent that rumors of a genocide were becoming a reality. FDR had been confronted by prominent Jewish Americans demanding the bombing of camps and railways leading to them. For lack of intelligence, FDR could not order such bombings. In fairness, most camps are located in Eastern Europe beyond the reach of American forces. It's very important to understand that at the time, that anti-Semitism was prevalent in both Europe and the United States, which ultimately led to slow action. And because of this, we're going to see upwards of 6 million Jews and 6 million non-Jews killed in the camps. Prior to the war, as Jews were fleeing Germany, a passenger liner arrived in Miami, Florida, called the St. Louis. And because of our immigration policies, because of the quotas, the U.S. government told this passenger liner, which is filled with Jews, to return back to Germany. And it was later learned that of the Jews on the St. Louis, over 80% of them died in the camps. So remember, so the United States, as well as other countries, and at the time of the purge, you know, really severely restricted Jewish immigration into their countries through quota policies. And ultimately, that's why so many Jews could not be saved as refugees prior to the war. So the last topic is the home front. You know, how did the United States win the war at home? This is very much in line with our World War I way of thinking. What impact did the war have on the home front? Now, of course, the Japanese expected that once experiencing Japan's power at Pearl Harbor, the United States would refrain from further conflict. The day after the raid, the Japan Times boasted that the United States was now a third-rate power and was, quote, trembling in her shoes. Americans were trembling, however, not out of anger and rage, but out of anger and rage, not fear. And they set out to prove Japan wrong. So after Pearl Harbor, young men flooded to the volunteer recruiting centers the next day. Millions and millions of men going to flood into the armed services. In fact, due to not just volunteering, but the draft, we're going to have a total of 16 million men and women will serve in the military. 1 million African Americans, 250,000 women will serve in non-combat groups like WAC and WAVES and WAFs, okay, as, you know, nurses, as pilots. That's what WAFs are. They become pilots and other support positions in the government or in the military. 33,000 Japanese Americans will enlist. In fact, the 442nd Regiment Combat Team, which is an all-Japanese fighting force, was the most highly decorated unit, American unit, in the entire war. Native Americans, 25,000 Americans are going to serve, 300,000 Mexican Americans are going to serve. So this is arguably one of the most diverse fighting forces ever assembled at this time in the war. So upon receiving his draft notice, I love this quote. One African American said, quote, just carve on my tombstone, here lies a black man killed fighting the yellow man for the protection of the white man. Very interesting quote. So just like in World War I, American factories are going to be retooled for wartime production. We're going to have the War Production Board. It's going to be established to regulate the use of raw materials. Of course, one half of all factory production went solely into war materials. 1943, U.S. is now producing twice as many war materials than all countries combined. Shipyards or factories were quickly retooled from peacetime to wartime production. So, for example, a maker of mechanical pencils instead turned out bombs. A bedspread manufacturer made mosquito netting. And a soft drink company switched from filling bottles full of liquid to filling shells with explosives, right? So also, you think that this is the first war in which the American GI was lice-free, disease-free. So we had significant advancements in medicine. And by the way, this is the first American war in which the leading cause of death was not disease. So a lot of the advancements in medicine and in science are going to contribute to victory. So we not only win the war in the factories, we're going to win the war also in the science labs, in the laboratories, and amongst the different innovators. Shipyards and defense plants are going to expand at a huge rate. I need to retype that. They cranked out tanks, planes, ships, troop transports at an astonishing rate. You can see, obviously, in the picture here, a tank factory, which I want to say this is Ford Motor Company. Ford Motor Company went from making automobiles to making all types of military equipment. You know, bombers, planes, you name it. In fact, during World War II, Detroit City did not make a single automobile. Not a single automobile was manufactured. Every one of these plants were converted to making war materials. Workers worked at record speeds, and parts were made at the factory. Women turned out, I mean, you were talking about what one thing that wartime does, war is really, really good for civil rights, for expanded rights. And women really stepped up. Of course, there was a pretty legitimate fear among business owners that there was not enough workers to meet both military and industrial needs. And so by 1944, we're going to have 18 million women working in both. Like World War I, women joined the workforce in huge numbers. Over 5 million women moved into the factories. And the majority of all non-factory jobs went to women. So it really opened up a lot of economic opportunity. The government carried out propaganda campaigns to encourage women to take up factory work, as well as other needed forms of labor. Obviously here, it's a very well-known propaganda poster, the Rosie the Riveter campaign. Of course, women were sought after by these factory owners because they were going to be paid 60% of what men made. So this is a way of really dropping wages down. But despite this, overall, you talk about women's wages increasing, but the standard of living in the United States is going to climb considerably because of increased women in the workforce. Now, there were many concerns that women might struggle in the heavy industries. Could they use, could they weld, could they work rivet guns? But boy, they proved their worth. They proved their worth. And women were causing consternation among men. Women were so effective in the workplace that men, and I actually included an outside reading here, where they interview this American GI who basically says, you know, he's over in Europe fighting somewhere. And so he's being interviewed by this you know, magazine, I guess, whatever. And it basically says, you know, when I get home from the war, you know, I fully expect women to go back into the home and I want my job back. You know, so there's a big fear here that these women and people of color especially are going to be taking jobs from the soldiers who are off fighting in the war. Another major issue, you got to know this, is very important, is we have a very important migration stream during World War II. This is called the Second Great Migration. You got blacks moving out of the South into northern industrial centers where wartime production is occurring, and of course out to the west. That's where the shipyards are. So you really start to see a massive movement of blacks out of the South. But you also see the second migration is the development of the Sun Belt. The Sun Belt stretches from Southern California, all the way across to Georgia. Okay, this is the Sun Belt. So the two migrations are going on. You got the second migration, which is African Americans leaving the South and going to these urban industrial centers to take up factory work, wartime jobs. Okay, and then you've got the second migration are whites, white Americans, people from the North moving into the South, because in the South, like Houston, New Orleans, and the like, because this is where a lot of new defense industries, aircraft factories, for example, are being relocated. Now you think, well, why in the world are they putting factories in the South? Because the labor is really cheap down there, right? The labor is really cheap down there. So so that's the development of the Sun Belt, massive movement of people, both out of the South in terms of African Americans, but of course, a counter migration of folks moving into the Sun Belt. So what we have during World War II is you got this big giant war on inflation, with greater numbers of Americans working and incomes increasing. They were confronted with a shortage of consumer goods, and this resulted in inflation. The government took steps to remedy the situation and control it. As you can see in World War I, inflation went up 170%. But however, World War II, inflation only went up 29%. So they were successful. So how did they do it? Number one, the War Labor Board. The War Labor Board was created to help maintain workers' standard of living and in order to try to ensure that wages kept pace with the rise of the cost of living. So when you say that the rise in the cost of living, we're talking about inflation. So we want to make sure that wages keep pace with inflation. So if inflation is going up 29%, then you want wages to go up 29%. Then you got the Smith-Conley Anti-Strike Act, 1943. Gave the government the power to seize plants and mines that were affected by strikes. So there were strikes during World War II, but the government were giving expanded power to go in and seize these factories, to seize the mines that were being affected by strikes. So the work did not end. Then you got the Office of Price Administration, the OPA. I think this, of the three, this is the most important. They were responsible for freezing prices and rents at 1942 levels. So you're talking about freezing prices, right? I mean, so administering the government's rationing program, that's the big one, right? The rationing program was aimed at conserving resources for the war. And they had two different types of plans. They had a certificate plan. And so essentially, if you wanted to purchase a tire, a car, vacuum, or any big item, you would have to go to a rationing board and you would have to get a certificate from them. Okay. And they were, by the way, very rare. I mean, people were not allowed to buy tires and cars and vacuums. I think the average American family was limited to one tire a year, you know? So it was pretty stingy. Then you got your coupon plan, and that's what you see there in the middle, this ration book here. The coupon plan, basically families were issued coupon books with which to buy everything, to buy meat, coffee, sugar, flour, gas, you name it. And so when you went to the butcher, you know, you bought your pound of ground beef. You would have to give the butcher your money and then a coupon. And then once you used your coupon, then you couldn't buy any more beef. You know, so you can only buy like so much a week. You're only given so many coupons a week, and you had to use those coupons in order to buy these products. I think gasoline. I think the average American was limited on average to 9 gallons of gasoline a week. So there were a lot of carpooling. There were a lot of people walking. There were a lot of people riding riding bikes, taking mass transit. But with this, and I think we're seeing this with the coronavirus, is there was widespread corruption, price gouging, hoarding. You know, shoot, raise your hand if you did not see hoarding in this current coronavirus event. And of course, activity on the black market. So there was a lot of shenanigans, but nonetheless, people were asked to ration. And here you see some government propaganda really encouraging Americans to do their best with rationing, to sacrifice, to do without. You know, to plant victory gardens, to plant, Victory Gardens. Just the way that we today are being asked to sacrifice and to be inconvenienced due to the coronavirus, you know, out of national duty, out of patriotism, out of love for your neighbor, you know. There is other, I've got some other propaganda here. I like this. We want your kitchen waste. So don't throw out food, you know, feed, let's feed animals with it, you know, compost. Women, save your oil, save your waste, you know, for explosives. You know, hey, we'll take care of the rising sun. You take care of rising prices, you know. So the government really produced a lot of propaganda to really help convince Americans that it takes all of us to fight inflation, you know, to fight inflation and to save and to kick back and to reserve vital resources for the war. Here's an example of a rationing card. So every time you go to fill up, okay, the person filling up your car, by the way, in those days, you didn't fill up your own car. There was an attendant that would fill up your car for you. And so you give him this rationing card and you give him the cash and he would stamp it. You know, he would, as you can see, he would stamp it. And of course, when you ran out, I mean, you were out of gasoline for whatever amount of time this is good for. I bet this is a week, that each unit is like a week. So we talked about carpooling, you know, sharing a car. You know, when you ride alone, you ride with Hitler. You know, so don't take unnecessary trips. You know, limit your trips. Also, there is propaganda aimed at getting people to, you know, there's a big fear of espionage and spies being in the United States. The idea that if your Uncle Jim is shipping out on Monday from New York to go to England, you know, kind of keep that to yourself because you don't want to alert spies that a new troop transport is on its way. So this whole idea of loose lips sink ships. Loose talk can cost lives. You know, so here you got, you know, they're talking about, hey, honey, you know, I'm shipping out on Tuesday. Well, guess who's listening? That's Adolf Hitler. But, you know, loose lips sink ships. You know, careless talk. Someone talk. And our homework with Dr. Seuss, right? Dr. Seuss, Theodore Geisel. I put a link to a lot of his propaganda that he made. Keep us flying. Buying war bonds. Like World War I, the government was really involved in helping to finance the war through selling war bonds. And buying war bonds was a way that Americans could contribute to the war effort by helping to finance the war. Over here on the far right, you got that's Dwight Eisenhower, arguably one of the more famous Americans in the kind of a face of the war. There's propaganda aimed at women, getting them into the fields, into the factories, canning of food. So next we have got African Americans. So one thing is true, and I put it up here, one of the most important developments that come from the war at home was the beginning of the civil rights movement in the United States. So African Americans are going to see better economic conditions. We'd already talked about the second Great Migration, where five million blacks are going to leave the South for the industrial centers and shipyards in the North and the West Coast. Obviously, they sought to escape the repressive Jim Crow system. Okay. A. Philip Randolph, he's going to emerge during World War II. He's considered to be the father of the civil rights movement. This is required reading right here. Both of these are. In which he, you know, basically what was happening is when the war broke out, African-Americans were being shut out of good paying defense related jobs. So he demanded that FDR end discrimination in seeking these jobs. And he did so by threatening a march on Washington to protest. And of course, FDR did not want this to happen. So he responded to this threat of a march on Washington by issuing Executive Order 8802, which set up the Fair Employment Practices Committee. And it opened up government, defense-related jobs to people of color. Randolph also wanted FDR to desegregate the military. And end segregation in federal agencies. But here, FDR did not comply. So what African-American civil rights leaders are going to push, it's called the Double V campaign. That means victory at home, right? No, victory abroad, victory at home. That by fighting in World War II, as you see, there are 2 million African-Americans that are serving in defense plants and shipyards, 1 million are actually serving in the armed forces, that by fighting in the war, they're fighting for civil rights at home, right? And of course, during the Second World War, the membership of the NAACP is going to increase from 50 to 500,000, okay? And you know what the great irony of the war is? I mean, here we are. The United States is fighting one of the most racist countries ever to exist, the Nazis. And it was a country that the United States railed against as evil. But yet our nation had Jim Crow and racial discrimination at home. And so World War II really showed the hypocrisy of the fact that we're fighting these Nazis because they are, you know, white supremacists, they're racist. But yet we are too here at home. And that's really what civil rights leaders wanted to point out. So make sure you read those too. You got the Tuskegee Airmen, of course, an all-black fighter wing, very distinguished, very well decorated. African-Americans, like in World War I, play a tremendous role in the outcome of the war. This is also an awesome outside reading about Eleanor Roosevelt's visit to Tuskegee. So, yay. Mexican Americans, 1942, the United States was in desperate need of increased farm production. In order to supply enough labor for this production, the government instituted the Bracero program. You need to know this. This is a guest worker program that brought in 150,000 Mexican workers into the United States to work as guest workers. Okay, it's the Bracero program. So they did provide a great need. Right, provided great need in farm production. Of course, as I mentioned before, 300,000 of Mexican Americans will fight in World War II, but didn't come without a little racism. If you look at the Zoot Suit Riots, young Mexican American youths became targets of racial violence in Southern California. The attacks were initiated by U.S. sailors and Marines who were on leave. This is largely in L.A. And of course, the Zooters were constantly in the media being portrayed, being connected to crime, gangsterism, thuggery by the local press. So, you know, obviously the white population in Los Angeles already pretty much profiled these young Mexican-American youths as troublemakers. The Zooters also wore jackets with excess cloth, at a time in which rationing prohibited such garments. And so this was viewed by U.S. servicemen and others as unpatriotic. And so what occurred were called the Zoot Suit Riots, where Zooters would be beaten up, their clothes stripped off, and their hair cut. And obviously these riots were racially motivated. The leaders at the time, the city leaders at the time, were quick to blame the Mexicans, but later analysis really painted a different story. Lastly, we've got the Japanese Americans. Obviously, executive order, you need to know this, number 9066. FDR declared the West Coast a war theater. And as a part, we're going to, people of Japanese descent, Americans of Japanese descent, 110,000 of them, are forcibly going to be relocated to 10 locations located in 7 states. As part of the process of being relocated to these camps, each family was only able to bring with them what they could carry, and the average internee was only given 48 hours to dispose of their belongings. And It is estimated that Japanese Americans were only able to retain anywhere from 2 to 5% of their total property. The remaining property would be essentially liquidated. The camps were located in very remote and very harsh, or very in areas where the climate was very harsh. And the irony is that there was never an act of sabotage linked to a Japanese American. And I think that's important to say, that really through, even through the Japanese internment camps, there was never an example of Japanese espionage, and there's never an act of sabotage carried out by a Japanese American. So Japanese Americans, through this, are going to remain incredibly loyal Americans. Of course, the camps were closed in 1946. In 1988, President Ronald Reagan approved the payment of, I believe it's $20,000 to every internee affected by the Japanese internment camps. Reparations are going to be paid to those who were affected by the internment camps. So that obviously the Japanese internment camps, Executive Order 9066, is the worst civil rights violation during World War II, during the Second World War. Korematsu versus United States ruled that the Supreme Court cannot overturn a military order. The building of those camps were a military order. They ruled that persons could not be held once loyalty was established. But really, by the time this court case came out, the camps are going to be gradually being disbanded. So that concludes World War II, American World War II. Appreciate your attention. Have a great day.